Welcome to the SBI Podcast, offering CEOs, sales and marketing leaders ideas to make the number.
Welcome SBI Podcast listeners and video podcast viewers. My name is Eric Estrella and this is Dan Perry. We are with SBI, a sales and marketing consultancy dedicated to helping you make your number. On this web TV show and audio podcast, we will feature topics and tutorials that will help you make your number. By tuning in, you can leverage emerging best practices and receive how-to instruction on some of the most prevalent go-to-market problems that exist in today's complex selling world. So, Dan, do you ever wonder why some companies make their number every year and some struggle with consistent performance? Companies come to us every day and ask for help to get more consistency in making their number. But most don't even know where to start, and it's really with strategic alignment.
Yeah, it is, Eric. So let's define what the heck strategic alignment really is, right? Strategic alignment begins with a clear understanding of the corporate strategy, followed by a grasp of the interdependencies among the various functional strategies. And to truly be strategically aligned, you got to link these internal strategies with external market conditions. Now, Eric, it's been proven to be extremely difficult. And, you know, all our research, we found that 91% of companies are just misaligned. They don't follow the corporate alignment, right? And the main reason is the realization that companies really have tactics masquerading as strategy. This results in a lot of waste, or as we define it, as thrashing, right? Tons of work with little productivity gains.
Yep. Makes it difficult to actually make your number when you're doing that, right? So on today's show, we're going to discuss your ideal customer profile and how your company can leverage it to prioritize sales and marketing efforts. Every company has an ideal customer profile, ICP as many call it. But typically, it's not quantitatively defined, nor is it documented. Most companies are calculating revenue potential by market level only, right? So they're not looking at the account level. But you really need to know the revenue potential by account, product, and buyer. When you, as an executive, have incomplete information, resources are not typically allocated correctly, and performance tends to fall short.
Now, Eric, I want to ask you a question, right? This ICP, ideal customer profile, it sounds kind of boring, right? So how do we explain this so everybody understands that it's really a critical thing in your organization? If you don't have this, your sales force is calling on people they shouldn't be calling on. Your marketing is marketing to people they shouldn't be marketing to. We got to explain this to the audience that it nails it right on the head.
Yep. So we're going to get into a great detail on today's show, right? But ICP, ideal customer profile. Okay. And this is done today, 9 times out of 10. It's just typically through tribal knowledge of the organization, but it's not necessarily documented effectively.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
If you think about it, strategy is about doing the right things, which is making choices on how to allocate people, time, and money. Today, we're going to help you make your 2016 number by demonstrating how to develop an ICP, quantify account potential, we talked about that a little bit at the beginning, and how to leverage this data in your go-to-market strategy decisions.
All right, so if you want to follow along at home, we highly recommend you use the SBI's annual research report entitled How to Make Your Number in 2016. Now, we're in step one of the 6-step revenue growth methodology, and developing an ICP, ideal customer profile, is part of this step one in this bucket of market research called account segmentation. So go get a copy of the workbook, salesbenchmarkindex.com/2016-report. And then if you want to have someone help you teach this, which we highly recommend, and use this account segmentation in ICP format, sign up for a workshop at salesbenchmarkindex.com/2016-workshop.
All right, here we go. So by completing account segmentation, we'd be answering the following questions in the account segmentation section of our market research phase, right? Remember, market research starts with market segmentation, goes into account segmentation, then buyer segmentation, and then user segmentation. We're going to focus on the account piece for the rest of this episode.
Okay.
Cool?
All right, I got it.
All right, so question number one, what is our ideal customer profile? And we asked about this a little bit earlier, right? So what defines our ideal customer or prospect? And again, we're going to get into great detail here in a second.
There's a difference, though, between a customer and a prospect, isn't there?
Yeah, customer is somebody that actually transacts with you today. Right. A prospect is somebody you're trying to attract
so
in the future.
Would they have two different ICPs or?
Not necessarily,
okay.
No.
Right.
No, because if we have a really good customer, great customer lifetime value, low customer acquisition costs, aren't we going to try to attract prospects
yep.
that have similar attributes, similar features?
Yep, got it. All right.
Perfect. All right, so second question. So how does each customer prospect score relative to one another on the ideal customer profile algorithm or math, if you will, right? So think about this. So if I have two prospects, you know, so we're going to create an algorithm that actually shows one has a stronger score than the other, right? I'm going to go after the one with the stronger score because we want to know what they are relative to one another. Does that make sense?
I got it. So I'm going to go after. I think that's a key word you said, right?
Yep.
Because if somebody calls me to buy from me, I'm selling them something. So I guess if I want to use the time that I'm not responding to active demand, or better said, maybe probably stimulating latent demand, then I'll, to your point, go after the highest scores that I have in my territory if I'm a sales rep for an ICP, or my patch if I'm, you know, have a bigger responsibility.
Yep. So when I say go after, right, so it's strategy, people, time, and money. Where am I going to allocate my resources? I'm going to go after the ones that actually have a higher propensity to buy, higher score relative to one another.
Okay.
Make sense?
Got it.
All right. So what is the potential spend for each ideal prospect or customer? Right. So again, you know, at the account level, this is where we're saying, okay, which one has the, what can potentially spend the most money with us? Right? So if it looks, smells, and tastes like another customer, company that's done business with us before and spent a lot of money with us, we'll then be able to kind of help predict the future by leveraging, you know, historical information.
So I got an ICP, right? I got what my ideal customer looks like. And then you're going to take all the accounts that I have and prospects I have and score them against that ideal customer profile. And then next to that, you're going to tell me what the potential spend could be.
Correct.
Okay.
Right. We're not Nostradamus here, so we're not going to predict the future for you.
Right. Okay.
But right, it's going to be directionally correct. And then again, we're going to go after the ones that have the highest potential versus others. And what it also does is it identifies the white space and potential additional spend within your customer universe as well.
Okay. So we're going to get into this, right?
In great detail.
All right.
Yep. So next question is, what is the cost to acquire each customer? Right. So this is an important question. We're not going to go into super uber detail on this today, but we're going to touch on that. Let's touch on it right now. Right. So the cost to acquire certain customers is going to be greater than others. Why is that? Could be sales channels, could be an enterprise account versus an SMB. It could be international versus, you know, domestic, you know, what have you.
Just a new business prospect, business development costs 3 or 4 times more than a current customer, right, to get business. I get it.
Yeah right. Absolutely. So again, right. So what's going to impact the bottom line? Low cost of customer acquisition and then high customer lifetime value, which is the next question up here. Right. So what is the lifetime value for each customer? Again, we want to go after the accounts that typically transact with us for over a long period of time, because as you mentioned a minute ago, it's cheaper to acquire or to get revenue from existing customers than it is to go out and find it in the existing prospect universe.
All right. So we're going to figure that out too. Customer lifetime value. Got it.
Right.
Okay.
So, and the last is, what is the propensity to buy for each prospect
now,
or customer?
Now, wait a minute, Eric. What the heck is propensity to buy? That seems so consultant speak.
It is. So, you know, we talked about scores, we talked about potential, and you kind of just start to marry all that stuff up, and you identify, all right, who is going to most likely transact with us, right?
Right.
Over a period of time. So, again, it's a lot of math, seems difficult, but we're going to walk you through it here.
Okay. All right. We'll do this. I'll take your faith. We got to teach these guys how to do this. All right.
All right. So, again, we're going to be focusing on the top three questions for the remainder of this episode. We're going to get started with that ICP, ideal customer profile. So, what is it? Straightforward definition is this. It's identifying the characteristics of an account that most values your products or solutions, right? Seems simple enough. But as previously stated, there are still salespeople that really kind of default to what you were saying earlier, Dan. Any company that has budget.
Hey, fog a mirror, I'm in, right?
Yeah. And as we all know, that seems like a path of least resistance. However, there's significant opportunity costs when somebody's just chasing down something that's not necessarily in the ICP, right? And it results in elongated sales cycles and actual lower average deal sizes, right? Marketing efforts aren't really focused on the right accounts. So again, we're not going to sit here and tell you that every company in your ICP is going to buy your product or solution tomorrow. But remember, we're identifying those organizations that have a higher likelihood to do so.
Well, I think that when we do this, right, our selling time of our salespeople, and then obviously the marketing time we put into marketing those people are more focused, and I think we'll get a better response.
Exponentially more effective.
Yeah. Right? Okay. Got it. All right, so let's discuss how you would render this ICP out, as Eric calls it, right? So for the purpose of this exercise, we're going to keep it simple and create an ICP for our fictitious company called Acme Corporation. No Wile E. Coyote here, Acme right. Corporation. Now, Acme Corporation sells a SaaS-based sales enablement tool. SaaS, for those people at home, is software as a service, all right? And they sell this sales enablement tool that helps B2B sales forces run sales plays. All right, so where do we begin? We're going to start with what we call firmographic information for our customer and prospect uniforce. Now, this means, Eric, what are the attributes of a company that we can find out before we have interaction with them via research, lists, and databases?
So you mentioned before. So yep. Why before and not after? I guess I'm a little bit confused there.
Well, that's for the prospect base, right? So we're actually going to search out firmographics that we don't have any inside internal influence or information about. And that's where this research comes into play to develop these firmographics.
Yeah, absolutely. So you're 100% right. So if you think about it, it's really about saying, okay, what can I find out about that prospect before I ever even engage with them that can tell me that, again, it looks, smells, tastes like somebody good that we have in our existing customer database.
Well, you know, Eric, I remember back when I was selling in the old proverbial, here's the phone book or here's a list, go call each one of them, and I'd pound the phones for hours on end, right? If I had a list like this, it could be a lot more impactful and, to your point, effective.
Cool. Can you give us a couple examples of firmographics or what that would look like?
Yeah, industry, company size, revenue and number of employees, company location, business to business versus business to consumer, etc. I think it's kind of like demographic information of a person. All right, so Eric, let's say you're in a male, you're in your 40s.
I am a male.
You're in your 40s?
No, 30s.
You're in your 30s. All right, yeah. Sorry, man. You make a certain level of income and you live in Southern California. Identifying these attributes helps us identify what good looks like for a certain type of organization that you will target. So let's go through these, right?
Right.
So how do you know what good looks like? Well, we usually start with history. So your best accounts, what are the attributes of those companies? Think about it through this kind of lens. What companies have the largest lifetime value to your organization and have the lowest acquisition cost? So in our Acme Corporation, a SaaS-based company, you got to look through that and say, what's our best current customers with the highest LTV, long lifetime value, and the lowest CAC, customer acquisition cost? So how would you do that? Where do you find that information, typically?
Well, you'd calculate it. What I don't want to do is go off down a tangent, right? I want to make sure that we are focused on ICP, like what we've talked about before. But customer acquisition cost would just be, you would like to do activity-based costing, and identify what are all the different activities associated with acquiring a customer, and the sum total is your cost of customer acquisition.
So you look at your own data, right? And
correct.
Figure that out.
All
right. Yep. Look at the second one here. You would then look by the most knowledgeable source of your ICP. That would be your products, marketing, and sales teams. These are the individuals interacting with the market on a daily basis. Yeah, your salespeople, right? Leverage those insights and incorporate them into the ICP formation.
Cool. So how does this really render out, right? Render out from a formulaic perspective, right? For our fictional company, Acme, our ideal customer profile is this. So what we're showing you here is a couple different modes, dimensions here that would be part of our ICP, right? It would be business to business only, employees between 200 and 5,000, company growth rate, greater than 10%, and sales and marketing spend greater than 25%. So why, right? So that's the big question. So we've talked about it before. What we do, we sell sales enablement technology, right? So our solution is best suited for growing organizations that have a large sales force, right? Large in terms of percentage of total number of employees.
That's easy.
Right?
Yep.
So they want to invest in their top line growth and we can help them do that.
So, but wait a minute, Eric, right? I'm looking at this graphic, and I see these percentages underneath every one of these factors. Like, we've got B2B companies, 30%, number of employees, 25%. What are those percentages?
Yep, that's going to be part of the scoring. Remember the different bullet points. You first identify the ICP, then you can score them one relative to one another. We're going to touch on that in a little bit more detail after the break, but that's where you see those percentages come from.
Okay. Now, I want to make a point, though. This ICP doesn't need to be the ICP for the next 5, 10, 15 years, right? It's not probably not even next year, but this is the one right now today. So when we make our go-to-market strategy decisions and investments, we're looking at our ICP first and foremost.
Yeah, so it's a good point. So again, just touching back on why Acme's is what it is today is because we identified, you know, smaller organizations that have a high sales and marketing costs that are growing like crazy, have the greatest need for our product, right? And we're going to focus on those, right? Low cost of customer acquisition and high customer lifetime value as it relates today. In 5 years from now, we might be more in the enterprise space where we're looking at larger organizations where we can actually go and help them there.
Okay, I get it. All right.
Cool. So we're going to take a quick commercial break, but stick around because when we come back, we're going to show you how to calculate account potential.
Do you have too many things to do and not enough time to do them? Is finding time to learn best practices almost impossible? The SBI podcast is your solution. Turn time spent exercising, commuting, and traveling into productive learning time with a subscription to the SBI podcast. SBI podcast listeners get unique insight into real-world sales and marketing issues through interviews with your industry peers every week. Find us on iTunes by searching for Sales Benchmark Index Podcast and subscribe today.
Welcome back. I'm Eric Estrella, and this is Dan Perry, and we're with SBI. Today, we're trying to help you make your 2016 number by demonstrating how to point your sales and marketing efforts to the right accounts. So we're using SBI's account segmentation methodology and the companion workbook to guide our conversation, right? We have reviewed how to create an ideal customer profile in the previous segment. In this segment, we're going to review how to calculate account potential. It sounds daunting, but stay with us. We're going to walk you through it. But before I do, I want to review the ideal customer profile for, again, our fictitious company, Acme, one more time. Right, so Dan, before the break, you asked me about those percentages,
yep,
right?
I did.
So as you can see, if for those of you following along at home, each one of these attributes, you know, the B2B companies, number of employees, so on and so forth, has a percentage associated to it. This is a weighting or scoring system, if you will. It's meant to score or weight certain attributes over another. In our example, we have B2B companies weighted higher than any others. Again, this is a simple illustration on how to demonstrate how the ICP renders out.
So hold on, right?
Yep.
Now, I know that we can change the percentages, but in this example, right, that you put together, and thank you, Eric, for doing that, I see here B2B companies at 30%, number of employees 25%, company growth rate 25%, et cetera, right? Where did we get those percentages? Were they just made up out of thin air? How did you calculate those?
No, it's a good question. No, they were not made up out of thin air. And without going down too many statistical rat holes, right, you can run some regression, some correlation analysis to identify which attributes have the strongest correlation to revenue, right? So B2B companies, for our instance, just happen to be one. Again, this is a simple illustration, but it could be you can do that in multiple ways, right? And you're going to have different ICPs for different sales channels potentially as well.
So you got four on here, right? The four that you mentioned. But I think there's more. Why don't you put 6, 7, 8, 10 on these things? Because I know that there's more the factors, right, that go into this type of Acme company and what they're looking for. Why not more?
Yeah, four was just an example. Usually I like to be in the 5 to 7 range because anything beyond that, they simply just start canceling one another out or just proxies for one another.
Well, you start to dilute the percentage of weighting too.
Totally.
Yeah. Okay.
Absolutely.
I got it.
All right. So now that you have this scoring system, you can then bump this formula and weighting against your prospect universe. And those that score best, again, we talked about this earlier, should be prioritized over those that don't. You know, it's the age-old adage, fish where the fish are, right? I'm going to put my marketing and sales dollars where the fish are, right?
Yep.
So if you recall the questions that needed to be answered by account segmentation, the scoring weighting of the ideal customer attributes were able to answer the following. Now, how does your customer prospect score relative to our ideal customer profile? Again, we know how our customers and prospect scores relative to one another as well.
Got it. Okay, so you're scoring to the ICP and against one another as well.
Correct.
Right, so the ideal state is I'm a sales guy in a territory, and I'm looking at my quote-unquote list of accounts or prospects, and each one of those should have a score that matches to the ICP or not match the ICP, right?
Correct.
Yep, got it. Yeah. And then next to that's also this account potential. So let's talk about this, right?
Perfect.
So what is account potential? Again, another straightforward definition is the revenue over the book or bookings potential at the account level. So it's based on historical performance of similar accounts. Okay, similar accounts. So how do you figure this out? Again, we start with history, but you would follow a few distinct steps. Number one, segment your current customer base into logical clusters, right? So industries, using industry, size of company, company growth rate could be the factors of your ICP potentially, right?
Yeah, so it's absolutely right. So you think about this, right? So you have 1,000 companies in there, right? There are logical, you know, clusters that you can just kind of put them into buckets, if you will, right? You know, you have manufacturing companies above $1 billion or between $1 and $10 billion and different things like that. So you would actually just break these up into, say, similar companies to like companies.
Interesting. All right, so I break them up. I don't want to get too confusing here, so you got to help me through this, right? But I break these up into clusters. Then I determine the spend for the upper quartile of the accounts in each one of the clusters. So the top 70, or the top 25%, I'm sorry, or the bottom 75%, right? Now, this sounds pretty complicated, but it's probably pretty easy. It seems it's merely to determine what a good looks like. And you don't want to use the average, right? You don't want to do 50% because you should not be targeting average accounts. I get it. So, you shouldn't use the top spending accounts per cluster because you want to account for the outliers, you know, the one-offs, certain situations. I get it.
Yep. So let me just see if I can just kind of let me break this down, right? So if I have 10 companies here, right, and then each one of them has some type of spend associated to it. Right, you have 10 organizations. I'm not going for number 5 because I don't think that's realistic. Number 10 is probably an outlier in terms of the 10 being the top one. So it's an outlier. So I can't really expect that of every organization. So if I'm in that 7.5 to 8 range, again, we talked about 75th percentile, 80th percentile of accounts, then saying, okay, that should be my optimal spend for similar types of customers, that's how we actually get your potential there.
Got it. Okay, so now I'll get an account or a prospect. I'll get a score to my ICP, and then I'll also, kind of in theory, next to that, we'll get a potential of what that account could spend.
Correct.
Now, what about the ones over the 75%? They don't have any spend left?
Well, not necessarily, right? And again, what we're saying is you're not going to get a deal that's going to exceed that potential. It's really to just give you a foundation, another data point that's directionally correct to ultimately say, all right, hey, this is where you want to go focus. If it's you have a good score, and you know, combined with a lot of potential, you know, those are the prioritized accounts.
I'm starting to figure this out.
Cool.
Yep.
So, by doing what Dan just described, you now have a profile spend for each account, just like we kind of walked through that example here. You can then apply this spend to your current customer base and determine how much more potential there is. So again, so let's pause there. So when we said, you know, we're looking at the prospects, we're also looking at your current customers, right? So within those in those clusters, you still have a bunch of accounts that are in that bottom quartile, in that, you know, bottom half.
Now, Eric, I used to be a sales leader, right? And you know what popped in my mind? Quota assignment for each one of those accounts. So if I'm given in a farmer role or account manager role and I got all these accounts and I got potential spend, that's the quota on that account.
Yeah, and that's likely just your white space, right?
Yep.
So what other products could you be selling into there, right? You know, are you getting the maximum value of whatever solution you sold them 2 years ago, you know, from a revenue standpoint? So there's probably additional white space there.
And I'm thinking compensation plans, right? I go right to compensation and forecasting. So, so as a former sales leader, right, I know exactly what I'm talking about here. But it seems like to me an ICP is a foundational element.
Yeah, just understanding what the account segmentation, account potential, ideal customer profile, it's huge, right? And we're going to get into a lot of detail here in the next segment.
Okay.
So, Remember, the expectation shouldn't be that every account will hit the exact potential number you assign to it, nor should you not expect big deals that will exceed the calculated potential. This is meant to help you prioritize your resources, point the guns where the most potential is. So, Dan, we're going to take a quick commercial break, but stick around because when we come back, we're going to show you how to best leverage this data within your company today.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Making your number is hard. Your problems are complex. Complex problems need complex solutions. Introducing the SBI Magazine. Read in-depth stories written by award-winning journalists about how your peers have overcome their problems to make the numbers. When you need more than a tweet, social post, or blog article, turn to the SBI Magazine. Go to salesbenchmarkindex.com to subscribe.
Welcome back. I'm Dan Perry, and this is Eric Australia, and we are with SBI. Today, we are trying to help you make your 2016 number by demonstrating how to point your sales and marketing efforts to the right accounts.
We're using SBI's account segmentation methodology and companion workbook to guide our conversation. We've reviewed how to create an account potential in the previous segment. We'll now review how to best use this information in your organization today. So, let's start with how would the marketing team use this information, right? The first would be demand gen. So we all know spray and pray approach of yesteryear isn't terribly effective, right, from a marketing strategy standpoint. When campaigns are targeted to your ideal customer profile, your demand generation increases by 5x.
5x?
5x.
Come on, Eric. That's like a big, bold. That's huge.
Yeah. So from a campaign standpoint, right, you have A-B testing. You can A, test on just a certain piece of content. Right. You'll usually get a 10% lift by just changing the content or the ask, right? But if you actually go B test and do ICP and target the right account that somebody has a higher propensity to buy, you have a 50% improvement. So that's a 5x improvement.
Yeah, but the marketing guys will like that, huh?
I'd hope so. Right, lead management. So when inbound activity starts trickling in, how are you scoring leads, right? Traditionally, a lot of organizations are using a BANT, budget, authority, need, and timing.
Wait a minute, budget, authority, need, and timing. That's pretty traditional.
It is very traditional, right? It's not necessarily, there's nothing wrong with it. You know, it's an approach, but as an approach, really, you can now to start to leverage and prioritize your ICP and newly created account potential to prioritize your lead qualification criteria. Remember, you have a database of accounts that you can now reference, right? And you can bump up those incoming activities against that database, right? So if now I'm not worried so much about BANT, I'm looking about, do I have a really good account, attractive account against my ICP with a ton of potential? I'm gonna prioritize that over timing.
So
as a SMB market.
What I think about is that you now are bumping up against the ICP. You're probably gonna get a better sales qualified lead or lead that's sales ready. And this could have downstream implications. What I mean by that is we talked about CAC before, remember? Customer acquisition cost. Mm-hmm. You probably can increase your lifetime value and lower your CAC because you might need less salespeople because the leads are so good, because you're targeting the right ideal customer.
So let me give you an example. Dan, you're a sales guy, right? So this is a great benefit of having, you know, lead qualification be off of ICP. You get an inbound, typically your inbound leads are what? You're looking at it and like, what am I going to do with this, right? This isn't fantastic.
All the time.
Just going to throw it away. But now you actually have inbound leads that are associated to your ICP. So now you're actually saying, oh, wow, this is attractive because it's in my ICP. They have a ton of potential. I'm going to go after it, right? So it leads to more follow-up action and actually greater alignment between sales and marketing as well.
Yeah. So I can see it. Yeah.
Let's revisit Acme as an example from earlier in the show. At Acme, if an account has an account, sits smack dab in the middle of our ICP and has potential to spend based on historical similar accounts or like accounts, I'm going to prioritize that account above all others for my nurture paths and scoring algorithms, right? Those are a couple of big rocks. But think about it like this. How do you point your marketing resources towards the accounts with the most potential and the highest propensity to buy?
You know, you mentioned scoring algorithms, and I think I just heard some video podcast shut the TV off, right, or shut the set off. What does this mean, scoring algorithm? That's a big word.
Yeah, it's a formula, right? You know, we just talked about a scoring system, right? You know, everybody uses scoring or weighting to prioritize certain different things, right? An algorithm is just a big word for a scoring system.
All right, got it. All right, let's move into sales now. We covered a little bit about marketing, and now the sales guys are in up to bat. So remember, you now have a list of accounts that have a quantified potential. Assume for a minute that this is directionally correct. We can leverage this data for multiple data-driven decisions. So let's take an example, right? Territory design. So territories can be created that are based on a bottoms-up potential. And so does quota setting, right? Versus just assigning a rep in an NFL city because we think there are multiple companies there that have a headquarters over there.
Right. So let's say we have an NFL city.
Yep.
Jacksonville.
Yeah.
It's an NFL city.
It's a lovely place, yes.
Yeah, absolutely. So we're just going to put a rep there because there's a football team there versus actually saying, you know, maybe in Chicago, or it's probably a bad example, but another, Sacramento, where there might be more rich. Portland, Oregon. There's more organizations that fit our ICP than there would be in, you know, even Chicago.
Well, I think I look at it two ways, right? So you said Jacksonville to begin with. You put a rep in Jacksonville just because it's an NFL city, and you don't put one in Orlando.
Right.
Right? Because it's not an NFL city. But, according to the ICP, Orlando could have a lot more prospects and accounts than Jacksonville. So it really makes educated decisions on territory design.
Correct.
Yeah.
But it's also, too, it's a bottoms up, right? So we actually have potential at the account level. So we know what the territory potential is for those specific territories once we slice and dice them.
I got it. I mentioned quota setting, right? Often quota is a number that comes down from the top and has what we call a peanut butter spread across the organization. And that's really saying if a quota is $100 and you got 100 reps, everybody gets a buck. Right? Mm-hmm. And that's just wrong. Because when armed with data, a bottoms-up approach with potential at the account level, quota no longer becomes a guessing game. You actually can directionally target what your quota could be. Yeah. And then finally, just another thing comes to my mind is coaching, right? Think about your frontline managers. If they are armed with the highest priority accounts, they can point their respective reps in the right direction and then target those accounts as well, too. And when they go on field rides and they provide coaching. So it goes all the way through not only just territory design, quota setting, and obviously compensation, but through enablement and coaching. So an ICP affects everything.
Yeah. If I think one more example, it would be this. It's really about talent, right? So think about like this, because now we actually have data. So we might have a rep in New York that's been killing it theoretically over a peanut butter quota spread versus a guy that's in Bismarck, South Dakota, right? And they have the guy in Bismarck's been doing 80% of his number for the last 5 years, but the guy in New York's been doing 120%. But really, when it all boils down to it, the guy in Bismarck might actually be a better sales rep because we've now identified that he's been actually exceeding the potential in his territory for the last 5 years, and then the guy in New York has been vastly unsuccessful against hitting the potential that sits in New York as well.
You know, Eric, it seems to me that if you haven't calculated an ICP, you're really behind the curve.
Yeah, I totally agree. So, again, those are just a few examples of ways to leverage the quantitative data, but the exercise is really meant to use data in your strategic decision-making process. Remember, strategy is the allocation of people, time, and money, which means you need to decide what you will choose to do and almost as equally important, what you will choose not to do. Account segmentation enables you to do that. So let's review what we discussed today. We have shown you how to create an ICP, how to calculate account potential, and lastly, how you best leverage that data.
Yep. So we'd like to thank you, our viewers, for tuning in. If you enjoyed this show, I suggest you subscribe to SBI TV at salesbenchmarkindex.com, or you can find us at our SBI YouTube channel. We have some outstanding content coming in future episodes that you will not want to miss. So until then, we wish you the best of luck as you try to make your number.
This has been the SBI Podcast. For more information on SBI services, case studies, the SBI team and how we work, or to subscribe to our other offerings, please visit us at salesbenchmarkindex.com.